There is no trickier disclosure determination than when you find out that your CEO is quite sick. Do you disclose that to investors? If so, when? Today on Zippy Point. I'm Brock Romanek, and I'm a big fan of yous. Dealing with the decision over whether to disclose that your CEO is sick is one of the most challenging disclosure determinations you're going to have to make. It's an area where the law is ambiguous. There haven't been any SEC enforcement actions nor case law that solidly points you in a particular direction one way or another. So back in my corporatecounsel.net days, I blogged quite a few times about Steve Jobs before it became public knowledge that he was in bad health. There were rumors that he was ill based upon the way he looked, and the securities law issue arose. Did Apple have an obligation to say something? Clearly, it's something that the market wanted to know since he was so integral to the company's performance. And now, unfortunately, the issue of a CEO's health is increasingly in the news because of COVID-19. It's a much more common occurrence that an important officer at the company falls deathly ill. A number of companies have disclosed in recent months that the CEO had the virus, then reported subsequently that there was a recovery. Here are 9 things to consider when deciding what to do in this area. 1, no affirmative duty to disclose. 2, compare the stock exchange standards. 3, the CEO's right to privacy. 4, but there is a duty to update. 5, risk factors about dependence on key managers. 6, CEO CFO certifications when too sick to perform. 7, determining just how sick a CEO is. 8, if you disclose, what do you disclose? 9, tell the board. 1, no affirmative duty to disclose. So here's something fundamental that's hard for a non-securities lawyer to grasp, that under the federal securities laws, public companies do not have a duty to disclose something material except at certain points in time, although there are certain disclose or abstain circumstances that might require more immediate disclosure. So in legalese, this means that companies don't have an affirmative duty to disclose unless an SEC filing is required. These are the company's periodic reports, the quarterly report on Form 10-Q, the annual report on Form 10-K, which contains an MD&A. MD&A has broad materiality-based disclosure requirements. Then there is the Form 8-K. This is an SEC filing which is required to be filed within a few days if certain triggering events happen. The SEC has deemed that these triggering events are material enough to force companies not to wait until the next 10-Q or 10-K, the next periodic report. Finally, there's the exception to these SEC filing requirements, the disclose or abstain doctrine, under which companies or their insiders can't take certain actions until companies disclose all the material non-public information in their possession. Companies would then file a voluntary 8-K to get that non-public information into the marketplace, thereby making it public information. So I sort of just fell down a rabbit hole here explaining securities law 101, but none of these typically would apply to the situation where a CEO is in bad health. I will say this, companies do try to push out material non-public information in their possession in most cases because it's so hard to prevent leaks these days. This helps reduce the risk that insiders will accidentally or purposely engage in illegal insider trading. But the poor health of a CEO might be one of those circumstances where a company decides to hold that information close to the vest and tells those that know about the CEO's condition that they are restricted. They're in a blackout period and they are not allowed to trade in the company's stock. 2, compare the stock exchange standards. So looking beyond the SEC rules, companies also need to consider the rules of the stock exchange upon which their stock is listed. For companies listed on the New York Stock Exchange, its regulation states that companies are expected to release to the public any news or information which might be reasonably expected to materially affect the market for its securities. For NASDAQ-listed companies, its regulation requires this lengthy thing, and I'll let you read that in your own time. So under these regulations, it's a materiality determination where you ostensibly are weighing a mix of factors, including the relative importance of the CEO and the magnitude of the illness. However, the exchanges rarely enforce their listing standards, particularly in this area where materiality remains so objective. 3, the CEO's right to privacy. So what makes this issue so tough is that it's so personal. Being sick might not be something that you want the world to know. There's a privacy element to this. Some argue that by taking the job of the CEO, you relinquish your right to privacy. But notwithstanding that argument, I think it's fair to say that this is one area where the definition of materiality does take privacy into consideration. When it comes to personal information, just people feel uncomfortable outing someone, and nothing is more personal than when you're really sick. So the CEO's opinion about whether they want their status known out there as out there is a factor that you have to take into consideration. In fact, there's an argument that if you disclose that the CEO is sick, there's a good chance for recovery, that disclosing the illness itself actually creates more uncertainty than is necessary. It's going to confuse the market. 4, but there is a duty to update. So if you do disclose that the CEO is sick, there's a doctrine where you have a duty to update once you disclose something. So you'll need to report material developments regarding the CEO's health. Is the CEO's recovery going well? Are things going south? But here's where it can get really dicey. A company may have the duty to update, even if they have some sort of outstanding statement out there that the CEO's health is sound. So if one of your people says that the CEO's gaunt appearance at a recent event was due to a common bug, there's an argument that the company now has a duty to update if that's not the truth. Or since this example shows that the company was misleading to an extent, it's more of a duty to correct. That duty exists too. This is known as the half-truth doctrine, which provides that if a company speaks, it must include all information necessary to make the statement not misleading. 5, risk factors about dependence on key managers. So taking this duty to update a step further, let's talk item 105 of Regulation SK, the risk factors section. And I do have several other vid guides about risk factors, links to which are below, but I just want to mention that those videos. Because check them out in your own time. So a common risk factor that companies disclose in their SEC filings or as part of their safe harbor for forward-looking information is that the company is dependent on key management personnel. Ponder whether having that in your risk factors changes your analysis at all about whether maybe you need to make public that the CEO has fallen ill. This is a duty to update. Maybe the fix is including a sentence within your risk factor, do this now before the CEO becomes sick, that from time to time, key personnel may have illnesses which could be serious, might interrupt service to the company, and that the interruption might be permanent. That's serious. Of course, to investors, this kind of disclaimer is legal mumbo-jumbo and doesn't help them know really what's going on. But this is what securities lawyers do. They protect the company from liability by artfully drafting the disclosure. So CEOs and CFOs are required to provide certifications when a company files their quarterly and annual reports with the SEC. These certifications indicate in essence that they have read the filings and that they've blessed them. So maybe your CEO or CFO is so sick that they shouldn't be signing these Section 302, Section 906 certifications. They can't do what's required in the certification to be truthful. They can't say that they've read the filings and they've blessed them. In other words, at what point is someone so sick that they're effectively not functioning as a CEO and CFO? Someone else is doing that job for them. If so, does the company need to file a Form 8-K under Item 5.02, because they have retired, resigned, or have been terminated from that position? I have a separate vid guide about these Item 502 8-Ks, by the way. So these are the fact patterns that you're going to need to analyze and decide what to do. 7, determining just how sick a CEO is. So the CEO-CFO certification issue deals with the extreme. A CEO's health is so poor that they can't carry out their job. At that point, it's pretty clear that the company should disclose that. Arguably, it's clear that if their health is so bad that it affects their ability to carry out their responsibilities, it's material, right? That's the extreme. But what if the CEO isn't quite at that deathly ill stage? It's something less than that. After all, they're allowed to have sick leave. Many diagnoses involve decent chance of recovery. So maybe they're expected to fully recover in a month, but maybe they're going to be fairly incapacitated until then. Or maybe they're expected to be about at 75% of the way there in a month or so. What do you do here? This is a very challenging gray area once you get away from the extreme. 8, if you disclose, what do you disclose? So at a minimum, the disclosure should identify who's sick, the extent of their inability to perform, and the anticipated impact on the company. And here are some examples of disclosure that have been made from this Fenwick and West memo that was put out in December of 2019. 9, tell the board. So even though the obligation to tell the public about the poor health of a CEO is murky, I believe the consensus is that the CEO should inform the board about a serious medical condition so they can be ready to implement a CEO succession plan. The board has a right to know. As for how often that does not happen, that a CEO doesn't even tell the board for a while, I don't know, but I imagine it happens more often than it should. A CEO might not want to be seen as weak. Ego gets in the way, even in illness. CEO succession planning can be such a challenging area, and the fact that a CEO is ill can bring fears of being replaced to the fore.